A very good evening to all of you this evening. We bring to you yet another fresh feature of our Expert View series. Friday, we have with us Mr. Dharamkirti Joshi. He's the chief economist at CRISIL and brings him with him over three decades of experience in economic research and consulting. He's had an extensive experience in macroeconomic analysis, medium-term assessment of Indian economy and forecasting, as well as in public finance issues, both at the central and state levels. And he's been a consultant to the state governments on fiscal issues as well. Mr. Joshi he's also a visiting scholar to Economic Research Unit of University of Pennsylvania. And he's co-authored a book on state finances and several research articles to his credit. A very warm welcome to Mr. Joshi to this expert session this evening, which is on the monetary policy and the issues around that. So today's announcement of the monetary policy was much in line with the broad expectations. Central Bank has done commendable job in maintaining the country's economic and financial stability throughout the pandemic. Today also, RBI has continued its accommodative stance and once again reiterated growth to remain a priority. But of course, there are a lot of factors at play, and who other than the notable economist, Mr. Joshi, to talk to us on this subject. So with these words, Mr. Joshi, may I hand over to you for your presentation, please?
Thank you very much for that generous introduction, and welcome everyone to this session. So what I'll do is, I think, as was being pointed out, the monetary policy did not have any surprises, but I think that's not the interesting part. The interesting part is what is happening globally, domestically, which influences monetary policy. So I'm going to put today's decision in that context. So I think let me give you some top level messages. One is, of course, as I said, there is no surprise in the October policy. The rates were on hold. The stance was accommodative. The tone was quite dovish. And they said that they will remain accommodative as much as possible. And there was no indication of normalization, so to say. Growth forecast was unchanged at 9.5%, which incidentally is CRISIL's forecast as well. But inflation outlook was cut. So we're going to talk about that. I think what led them to first raise the inflation outlook and then reduce it to 5.3%. So which is also telling you that the story is quite dynamic, I mean, as far as inflation is concerned. Growth seems to be stabilizing somewhat. Then I think the other issue is what's happening globally. I think today monetary policy, as the governor was also pointing out, is determined largely by the domestic environment. But you can't say that in a globalized world, what the other central banks are doing doesn't have an impact. So I think that also influences to some extent the monetary policy trajectory, although it's not a dominant factor. And the global monetary policy environment, so to say, is now moving towards normalization, I mean, so which essentially means that the super easy monetary policy is now slowly going to normalize. And then I think tightening is still a long way ahead. I mean, it is only about making the policy consistent with growth and inflation outlook, which means normalization. The other message that I took away from today's policy was that, well, growth is picking up. We all know, I think the short-term indicators are looking good. But the RBI is still, I think, a little short of calling it sustainable recovery. If they were convinced, then I think they would have started the normalization process. So that's also one indication that growth recovery is there, but it is still in nascent stages, and actually it needs to be nurtured. Then I think the inflation, as this is a big driver of monetary policy, The worry is largely right now from the supply side. I think demand is not that strong. I mean, it's getting stronger, but still I think we have excess capacity in the system. Despite weak demand, the core inflation, which is reflective of demand, incidentally, continues to stay high. So that needs to be, that's largely, I think, as per RBI's and our assessment also, is largely a supply side phenomena. And I'll show you some of the charts from today's policy statement, which are quite interesting on how the costs have been rising. I think the most interesting part is that the food inflation is behaving well, and I think one reason is it's over a weak base, but the monsoons also help, and we'll talk a little bit about that as well. So I think overall story is that RBI's target is to move the inflation towards 4%, which is the central value of 2 to 6%, but they're not in a hurry to do that, and they will remain tolerant of inflation, which is somewhat higher as well. So I think CRISIL's expectation is that the RBI will start with the process of mopping up liquidity, I think, which will begin sometime this year. And the rate liftoff will not take place until next year. So I think there is some time before they think of raising interest rates. And there's no communication on that front as yet. So that is the overall message. And let me, I think, just very quickly, since I talked about the global outlook, let me very quickly take you through what's happening elsewhere. If I divide the world into advanced countries and emerging markets, what we see is that a number of small advanced countries, for instance, countries like Norway, South Korea, New Zealand, they've already raised interest rates. And New Zealand was the last one to raise it a few days back. And the reason is, I think they feel that the monetary policy has stayed loose enough, and I think the inflation is now becoming a concern. So they see inflation as a bigger threat than to growth. And also, I think the other larger advanced countries like Australia, Sweden, UK, I think they have started, they have not raised interest rates, but they have started cutting the asset purchases, the quantitative easing, as it is called. What is of interest most is what are the two systemically important central banks doing, which is the Federal Reserve and the ECB. Federal Reserve, I think, because the inflation has been surprising on the upside, I think what they've done is they regard the growth as becoming reasonably strong. Despite the fact that it has been hit by COVID a little bit and also by the rising costs, but overall I think growth is still quite healthy in US. And S&P, which is my parent company, believes that the tapering of asset purchases will begin by towards the end of this year, and I think then we'll see a policy rate liftoff sometimes in December 22. So that's a long time ahead. And this is this will be followed by other rate hikes in 22 and 23 and 24. So that's the expectation of the US policy. They have moved ahead the timeline. I think that is important. I think what's also interesting is that the Europe, which is where I think growth has become even stronger, the inflation is not so much of a concern there. I mean, and the ECB is comfortably on hold there. They're not talking about of tapering in any way. So I think from India's perspective, the crucial meetings from the two systemically advanced central banks will be in December, mid of December, Fed and ECB will meet. And I think that will have some bearing on what happens in India's policy next year. Well, emerging markets like Chile, Czech Republic, I think Brazil, I think they've already started raising interest rates. That doesn't mean that there is pressure on India to raise interest rates. I think their domestic conditions warrant an interest rate hike because inflation is going through the roof there in those economies. But I think the point I want to highlight through this slide is that now we are moving towards an environment where the monetary policy is no longer easy. It is moving towards gradual normalization. And I think we also probably will follow that path. And the timing will vary from country to country. But the process has definitely begun. I think very quickly on this, I don't want to spend time on this. This is just the high frequency data which everybody tracks and which even RBI looks at, and they also alluded to it today. I think whether you look at mobility or power consumption, or recovery in manufacturing and services as measured through PMIs or traffic congestion or tax collections. I think everything is telling you, this, these charts are telling you two things. One, that the second wave, which brought the healthcare system to the brink of collapse, did not hit the economy as well, as badly as the first wave did. I mean, you can look at the first chart and you can see the what happened to Google Mobility. You can look at power consumption. You can even look at the PMIs, I mean, which had fallen very sharply during the first wave. I think they were not hit that badly. So I think, so the point I want to make is that even if you get a third wave, we expect it to be mild, but even if it is, let's presume the worst, that it is not mild, the economy will not be hit to that extent. I mean, because now I think we are sufficiently vaccinated, getting sufficiently vaccinated. And on second factor is that we also learning to muddle through the virus. I mean, it's not going to, so the severity of the lockdowns will be much less. I mean, even if there is a worst case of a more severe hit, and the so I'm just painting a scenario where I think I'm outlining what could be the worst, but I think I don't think that is our base case scenario. And overall, I think we do expect the economy to gradually continue to build strength and record a growth of 9.5% this year. Now, I think the other thing, which is a month back, and everybody I think who tracks India looks at this, is the monsoon. I mean, now. But towards the end of the season, the monsoons have become normal at the national level. I think there was a scare about a month back when I think rains were about 10% below normal. I think the rains picking up late is not a very good sign, in the sense that I think there is a bunching of rain towards the end, and so I think sometimes it does damage to the crops, etc. I think, but that has become a part of the monsoons every year. What is really interesting is that the overall rainfall is quite good from kharif production perspective, and the reservoir levels, which matter for the next season, which is the rabi season, I think they are quite healthy. The groundwater situation is good. So I think agriculture looks quite good, and I think that's relevant from RBI's perspective, because I think, as Governor noted today, the vegetable inflation has been very, very low, and we'll talk about, I think, some parts of inflation as we go ahead. So this is one bit of good news, even though I think the distribution of rain has not been very good. Now coming to this chart, which essentially I think the point I wanted to highlight was that, one, that this is what I had been talking about. The second wave is like Mount Everest, but the stringency of the lockdowns is much lower. And I think in the last 1 month, what we have seen is that the number of cases which were sticky around, I think, 35 to 40,000 have started coming down. There are risks, obviously. I mean, the biggest risk is the new variant, if it appears. I think we don't know whether it will be, how infectious it will be, how virulent it will be, or whether it will escape the vaccine. So that remains a risk in everybody's calculation. And global experience so far is that vaccines do blunt the virus, but they don't defeat it, at least not as yet. I mean, so I think we need to be cautious on this front. I think, but all the indications right now are veering towards positivity, I would say. Now let's come to what's happening to the consumer confidence. I think RBI does these surveys, which I think they have highlighted in their report again. If you see the consumer confidence, there is a red dashed line and then there is a blue line. The red dashed line indicates the current confidence of the consumer. I think that's still shaken. I mean, although I think between the July and the September survey, it has gone up. And even I think for 1 year ahead, it has gone up. But look at the level of confidence compared to what it was, I think, in 2017, 18. It still looks, I think, it's the revival of confidence is going to take a long time. I think the good news is that it's moving in the right direction. I mean, and consumer confidence is very critical for a broad-based consumption recovery. Private consumption is, as we know, is about 55% of our GDP. Now let's look at the cost aspect. I think this, again, I think we've all been hearing about it, but I think this is Reserve Bank's Industrial Outlook Survey, which they released in today's report. And I think it very clearly shows, you can see the stress the firms must be in terms of cost escalations. I mean, whether it is the cost of raw materials, or it is the cost, is the salary outgo, or it is the selling prices. I think in the manufacturing sector, all of them have gone up, which means that the input costs are rising and the companies are passing it on, or at least they intend to pass it on to the end consumer. So which is getting reflected in core inflation part, which I mentioned. I think core inflation is still uncomfortably high from RBI's standpoint. Then I think even if you look at the services and infrastructure firms, I think the same story is playing out. I think input costs have risen, the salary outgo is going up, and also I think the selling prices are going up, which means that there is a pass-through which is happening. This is an expectation, but I think it is also playing out, because that's why you see wholesale price index being inflation being at close to 10-11%, and the CPI being close to 6%. So there is some pass-through that is happening, and CPI core being equal to close to 6% actually. And so I think this is one thing to be wary of. So companies either will take a hit on the margins, or they will pass it on to the end consumers. And I think both are happening. I mean, now let's come to the two big engines of India's growth are investment and consumption. There is good news on both the front, but I think it's good news of a different kind. I mean, if you look at investments, the government capex is clearly on track. I think the revenues are looking good. As a result, I think the ability of the central as well as the state government to maintain their what they had committed in the budget as capex, I think they're likely to achieve that, which is a good news. So this has a positive effect on the economy in terms of infrastructure always crowds in private investment, so to say. But if you look at the private capex, I have not giving the overall numbers, but I think let's look at some of the sectors. I mean, if you look at the large players in the core industrial sectors like steels, non-ferrous metals, or even cement, I think their capacity utilization is quite high, actually close to 75-80%, and they've managed to deleverage their balance sheets as well. But if you look at the smaller firms, I think it's not the same scenario. I mean, their capacity utilization levels are very low. Their access to credit is weak. And I think that's what the central bank has been trying to address. The point I'm trying to make is that it's a K kind of a shape which is emerging in the private capex as well. And even within consumption, you see the same, the broad basing of consumption still remains elusive, and that's reflected in RBI's consumer confidence survey as well. The nature of consumption is getting skewed towards high-income groups. I think the auto analyst I was speaking to the other day was telling me that in the luxury segment and of the automobile and in the middle to luxury segment, he said there are usually three categories. One is the base model. There is a middle model, and then there is a top model. There's hardly any demand for base model. So I think which means that wealth has gone up in certain categories, and same is not true of two-wheelers, which are a low ticket item. I mean, so there is again a K shape in income is also getting reflected in the consumption. So I was just giving example of automobiles. So I think the point here is that recovery is there. I think some parts of the economy are doing quite well, but the it's not broad-based as yet. So I think that's the reason RBI, despite the fact that they're maintaining 9.5% GDP growth, they still don't regard it as sustainable. Now coming to inflation, here I think, as I mentioned, if you look at the three major components of inflation, which is, I think we have data from April to August on top, food, which is close to 40%, core, which is 47%, and fuel, which is 6.8%. So between April to August this year, fuel inflation was 11.5%, core at close to 6%, as I was mentioning, and food has been the savior. And I think within food, what is happening within the key component of inflation, which is lying low right now? If you look at cereals, the retail inflation in cereals is -2% between April to August, which means that the prices of cereals taken as a group between April to August were almost 2% lower than they were during the April to August period last year. Now, the moment you shift from carbohydrates towards proteins, which I'm sure I think the health freaks would, I think, focus more on proteins, there I think the inflation is high. Pulses, 9% inflation, eggs, meat and fish, close to 10% inflation, and then edible oils at almost 31.4% inflation. So I think there is a dichotomy. There is a very different behavior within food. But overall, I think since cereals and fruits and vegetables, they constitute a large part of our diet and large weight in the consumer price index. So they are keeping the overall food inflation low. Now, what happens to core and what happens to fuel needs to be seen. Fuel, I think, is outside our control. Rupee has weakened. The global crude prices are above 80. So I think in that scenario, the fuel inflation will continue to remain high. What happens to core? I think part of the surveys I showed you from the RBI, which are pointing that input costs are rising and the output, the selling prices are also rising. So what this means is that there is pressure on inflation, which cannot be ignored. It's the food which is keeping us saved. So the trajectory of inflation is going to look something like this. The food inflation is going to continue to fall till November, December, because there's a very high base effect. In November last year, food inflation was at 11%. It's the hope is that after in the beginning of the next year, the supply side inflation, the input costs, etc., they will start coming off. And if that happens, then I think you will end up with an inflation of 5.3%. I think that's the reason why the central bank has cut its inflation forecast from 5.7 to 5.3. Expectation on inflation, I wasn't able to update this chart because I think I was waiting for some data, but clearly, I just want to highlight the fact that the inflation expectations are still close to 10%, whether you look at current or you look at 3 months ahead or 1 year ahead. But the interesting part is that between July survey and the September survey, they have come down by 50 to 60 basis points, which I'm not able to show in this chart, but I read it in the governor's speech. Now, I think let's look at the monetary policy setting. I think this is an interesting chart, so I want you to pay attention to it. If you see from FY11 onwards, the bar that you are seeing is showing the consumer price inflation, and the star within it is reflecting your repo rate. So the repo rate was below the inflation rate before we started inflation targeting. And I think once we started inflation targeting, which was somewhere in 15-16, I think what we saw was that the repo rate was always above the inflation rate. So one can say that the real interest rate was positive. So the depositors were getting positive returns on their bank deposits, and I think this also means that the interest rate was real interest rate was higher. But what happened during FY21 and 22 is that this got reversed. The inflation was high, but the repo rate was still brought down. So the real interest rate in the economy became negative and became supportive of activity. And so that, I think, contributed to what RBI calls the easy financial conditions. CRISIL has its own financial conditions index, which I have very quickly shown here. I think what I want to point out is that when we started monetary inflation targeting, which is somewhere from 2016 onwards, what we find is that the financial conditions became a little bit tighter and tighter. I mean, so they were veering towards the tighter, and they became very tight when the COVID struck us. But after that, I think the central bank, through its actions, interest rate cuts. I think the markets are remaining strong. I think all that is getting reflected in financial conditions again becoming easy, and I think they are now at the easier end. And till the time I think we see central bank follow accommodative policies, till the time rupee doesn't appreciate too much, markets remain strong. I think the financial conditions are likely to remain easy. The one risk to this is that if the Fed surprises the market, I think if they are able to glide their policy according to what they've communicated, that's fine. But if they were surprise the market, then I think the financial conditions from an external perspective could tighten. And then I think finally, this is our outlook table, the GDP growth at 9.5%. Consumer inflation, we had a forecast of 5.8%, which we will revisit. I think the when the September number comes out on the 12th, you'll find that you'll be pleasantly surprised. I think that's our expectation, that it's going to be below 5% and maybe closer to 4.5%. And this is largely because I think the food inflation would be down. Fuel and core will still remain close to their levels that they have been. Current account deficit position is going to turn from surplus to deficit in financial year 21-22. Rupee will weaken. Actually, it's already touched 75, which we had forecast for the year end, but rupee has been very volatile. So I think last year it was unusually strong. So I think some weakness in the rupee might take place. I think particularly if the central banks in the systemically important countries like US, I think they start withdrawing. I think good news is on the fiscal front. I think government will meet its target on fiscal deficit. And the 10-year bonds will gradually start lifting from these levels. And they've already touched 6.3 today. Our expectation is that by March, it will touch 6.5%. Because RBI would have started mopping up liquidity by that time. Even at 6.5%, the point I want to highlight is that it is still going to be below the average that we saw in the last 5 to 7 years, which was around 7.5%. So I think the broad message is that monetary policy is going to remain supportive till the time the central bank doesn't see signs of sustained and a broad-based growth. And I think so for that, COVID has to be under control, not only here, but I think also in the other parts of the world, because if a flare-up in some parts of the world, which are our trade destinations, would mean reduced demand. So I think it has to be, as it's said in the case of COVID, no one is safe till everyone is safe. So clearly, I think so once we start to, once the pandemic becomes an endemic, I think that will be the stage when I think central bank will start looking at raising interest rates. So let me stop there. Thank you very much for listening in so patiently.
Thank you so much, Dr. Joshi, for explaining, what's really happening in the economy and the context in which the RBI had to do its monetary policy and, some of the constraints that they may have to take into account. I think the whole detail about the inflation trajectory, you have, in a very layman's language, you have kind of given this information to our audience. So thank you once again for joining in, and I'm sure the audience will find it very useful, and we'll come back to you for other talks as well. So thank you once again.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.